Good evening, everyone. No other therapy has generated as much interest, controversies, and debates as the dietary therapy for obesity. So I am going to speak on low-carb diet, a new food obsession. India is encountering rapid changes in nutritional habits, and combined with genetic predisposition and sedentary lifestyle is leading to increased prevalence of non-communicable diseases. So dietary modifications and increased physical activity are the cornerstone for management of obesity. 21st century diet culture is promoting low carbohydrate diet as a new idea, but actually it existed since 19th century, and most of the diets are popularized and introduced like a bright flash, but they quickly fade away and are replaced by a new dietary concept. Over time, types and names of dietary therapy have changed, but the basic principle of energy balance remains the cornerstone of any weight management program. One type of diet may not fit the metabolic profiles of everyone to the same extent, but data suggest that all types of weight-reducing diets perform better than no intervention. So there seems to be an endless search for an appropriate, acceptable, and effective dietary therapy for weight loss. This discussion is an effort to understand the efficacy, health benefits, and long-term sustainability of low-carbohydrate diet. Now, low-carbohydrate diet, it contains carbohydrates below the recommended dietary allowance of 45 to 65% of the total energy. So either it is moderately low carbohydrate when it contains carbohydrates below 45%, or low carbohydrate contains less than 26%, and very low carbohydrate contains less than 10%. Now, as the carbohydrate amount is decreased, there is presence of ketosis. Hence, it is also known as low carbohydrate ketogenic diet. And as the amount of carbohydrates are decreased, there is proportionate increase in amount of fats and proteins. So this diet is also known as low carbohydrate high fat diet or low carbohydrate high protein diet. When the carbohydrate amount is decreased, the metabolism changes from glucocentric to adipocentric. And although no carbohydrates are consumed, liver and kidneys make about 200 grams of glucose from the dietary proteins and fat for the nourishment of the glucose-dependent tissues. In starvation, energy is obtained from endogenous sources like muscle protein, glycogen, and fat stores. Whereas in low-carbohydrate ketogenic diet, exogenous sources of protein and fat, as well as endogenous glycogen and fat stores, they provide energy, and there is no breakdown of endogenous proteins. Foods which are prescribed in low carbohydrate diet, the amount of carbohydrate depends upon different diets in Atkins, Banting, Paleo, or South Beach. But the consistent focus remains on limiting easily digestible carbohydrates and increasing foods low in carbohydrates, high in fats and proteins. The food items which are allowed are green leafy, cruciferous, and non-starchy vegetables, berries, raw nuts, seeds, fish, eggs, unprocessed animal meat, dairy products, natural plant oils, and fats. The question arises, is low carbohydrate a new obsession? Actually, it is not. It existed since 1797, and during 19th century, very low carbohydrate ketogenic diet remained the standard treatment for diabetes, and William Banting in 1863 described a low carbohydrate weight loss diet. Frederick Madison suggested a highly restrictive short-term dietary regime in early 1900. Subsequently, several low carbohydrate diets were introduced. Eat Fat and Grow Slim in 1958, Air Force Diet, Drinking Man's Diet in 1960, Stillman's Diet in 1967. The major breakthrough came in 1972 when Dr. Robert Atkins published Dr. Atkins' Diet Revolution, and this initiated the low-carb craze in the United States. Introduction of low carbohydrate has led to major controversies and failed to generate general consensus, even on interpretation of the results of specific studies. World Health Organization has recently suggested that free sugar consumption should be reduced to less than 10% of the total energy throughout life. So this is to be noted that throughout life, the sugar consumption should be reduced. Decrease of less than 5% of total energy consumption provides additional health benefits. Opinion of healthcare providers has been polarized. Some believe its usefulness, while others consider it as a fad diet. But there is strong evidence in favor of low carbohydrate diet. So evidence suggests that the type of carbohydrates consumed influence the risk from cardiovascular diseases. Studies showed decrease in weight, waist circumference, BMI, serum triglycerides, blood pressure, fasting blood sugar, blood insulin, and increase in HDL levels. But there was no change in LDL levels and serum creatinine levels. In 2013, a meta-analysis comparing different diets showed improvement in risk factors for cardiovascular diseases and diabetes with low carbohydrate, Mediterranean, low glycemic index, and high protein diet. Recently, Pure study concluded that there was an adverse impact on total mortality with high carbohydrate intake and lower risk of total mortality, cardiovascular disease, and stroke with intake of fats. Now, low carbohydrates and weight loss. Low carbohydrate, high fat diet is one of the strategies for weight loss since 1900. Dr. Atkins diet revolution renewed this interest in low carb, high fat diet. Evidence suggests that maintaining a low carb diet helps lose weight by tendency of selecting nutrient rich diet and increased feeling of fullness. Randomized trials has established advantage of low carb, high fat diet over low fat, high fat diets for weight reduction in adult population. The benefits of low-carb diets other than weight loss include significantly increased HDL, reduced HbA1c, and reduction or cessation of diabetic medications. Low-carb diet, they cause greatest weight loss early in the trials because of rigorous carbohydrate restriction. And studies showed that in 6 to 12 months, subjects gain weight because of increased daily ingestion of carbohydrates, known as carbohydrate creep. So this weight gain was because of the discontinuation of the low-carb, high-fat diet. And this observation is true for all dietary interventions, that decreased adherence leads to weight regain. So weight loss, it is not a destination, it is a journey throughout life. Common people who maintain dietary restrictions lose weight more than weight loss recorded in clinical trials. Three nutritional protocols were studied by a two-year dietary intervention randomized control trial and suggested that low-carb diet and Mediterranean diet are safe and effective alternatives to the low-fat diet with beneficial effects. Trials suggested that for those who may not follow a calorie-restricted dietary regime, low carbohydrate and non-restricted calorie diet may be optimal option. About 2.9 greater weight loss was observed by Atkins diet at 12 months. Jenkins et al. Developed a eco-Atkins diet for vegetarian Asian Indians. Two mechanisms of increased satiety and a specific metabolic advantage has been proposed for weight loss in people on low carbohydrate, high fat diet. Another randomized controlled trial concluded that a higher protein, higher fat, and moderately lower carbohydrate from lacto-vegetarian sources showed significant reduction in weight, waist circumference, and improved the cardiometabolic profile. Low carbohydrate, high fat diet in the management of diabetes mellitus. Before the discovery of insulin, carbohydrate restriction, fasting, or starvation was prescribed both for type 1 and type 2 diabetes. Presently, low-carb diet are gaining prominence as first-line dietary management for type 2 diabetes mellitus. Low-carb diet is slightly better in controlling glucose metabolism than a low-fat diet. Evidence suggests that any diet leading to weight loss improves glycemic control, but low-carb diet, even in the absence of weight loss, positively influences glycemic control. Low-carb diet are effective in weight loss and they improve the cardiovascular risk factors. Dietary guidelines for Americans recommends a low-fat diet and not low-carb diet. But a systematic review of 10 dietary trials found that coronary artery disease and overall mortality was not affected by reducing dietary fat. Conclusion of this meta-analysis did not support the recommendations of 2015-2020 dietary guidelines for Americans, suggesting to reduce fat. Evidence suggests that low-carb diet caused greater weight reduction and increase in HDL as compared to low-fat diet. But it is generally believed that increased dietary fat intake may increase the risk of cardiovascular disease, but data from numerous studies suggest favorable changes in many cardiovascular risk factors. There was greater decrease in triglycerides and increased HDL with low-carb, high-fat diet. But total cholesterol and LDL decreased significantly more with low-fat diet. Several other biological changes produced by low-carb, high-fat diet, like reduced ApoB levels, reduction in inflammatory biomarkers, decreased blood pressure, reduction in HbA1c, improved glycemic control and insulin concentrations, and reduction in the visceral fat and weight loss, would substantially decrease the cardiovascular risk. In non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, cardiovascular disease are the leading cause of mortality. Non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is a condition with increased triglycerides, low HDL and overproduction of very low density lipoproteins, and increased hepatic insulin resistance, believed to be caused by excessive carbohydrate intake. So it is thought that low-carb, high-fat diet reverses the non-alcoholic fatty liver disease and so decreases atherogenic dyslipidemia. Prevalence of metabolic syndrome was reduced from 58% to 19% in a lifestyle trial. But some misconceptions exist, hindering the prescription of low-carb, high-fat diet. A common error is to confuse nutritional ketosis with diabetic ketoacidosis, which is a life-threatening condition because of insulin deficiency. Carbohydrate restriction increases the production of ketone bodies by the liver. Existing evidence shows that the nutritional ketosis is safe and beneficial to many patients. Again, the question arises, is high intake of fats and proteins dangerous? Potential dangers are often expressed about the increased consumption of fats and proteins as a part of low-carb, high-fat diet. They cause some other dangerous effects like headache, fatigue, muscle cramping, but only in the adaptation period. And after that, most of the side effects subside. As excretion of the water and sodium is increased on these diets, so experts suggest increased sodium intake to minimize these side effects. Moreover, it is advisable to educate the patients regarding the transient nature of the side effects. Supporters of low-carb diet generally do not believe that low-carb diet causes exhaustion or weakness except in the adaptation period of a few weeks and recommend exercise as a part of healthy lifestyle. After adaptation, low-carb diet may not affect endurance but may adversely affect anaerobic performance, which depends upon glycogen. Low-carb, high-fat diet are nutrient-dense, supplying all the essential nutrients as they generally consist of unrefined food from vegetables, meat, dairy, seeds, nuts, thus replacing the traditional nutrient-poor carbohydrate diet. It is believed that low-carb, high-fat diet cause weight loss mainly by water loss. Definitely, evidence suggests that in first few weeks of carbohydrate restriction, weight loss is due to increased diuresis, but data also suggests that long-term weight loss is mainly because of loss of fat as well as non-fat mass. And more than 10 kg of weight loss seen in trials can't be because of water loss alone. So take home message is, diet has continued to generate great interest. Low carb diet have attracted international attention as World Health Organization has recommended reduction of overall consumption of sugars and easily digestible starches. Evidence suggests that low carb diet immediately induce a number of favorable and unfavorable effects, but long-term effect of these effects is presently not known, so there is need for more research. Until research has solved the problem of perfectly matching an individual to a diet, flexibility in choosing among many diets with measurement of intended outcomes should be recommended, and low carbohydrate diet are preferable option. There is nothing new in low carbohydrate diet but rejuvenated obsession and hype. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Sonia. If there is any questions.
And we are taking around about 1400-1500 calories per day in spite of 2700-2800. So we should reduce the, we will reduce the weight. But at the same time, how much protein diet we should take along with it?
About 15-20% of the total calories. Usually it is recommended 10% of the total calories should come from proteins, but you can increase up to 20%.
And high protein diet is harmful in that condition or not?
This much of protein, if only your kidneys are working properly, you don't have any kidneys problem, then it is okay to have.
No bad. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sonia. Now we are going to have a appreciation session. Please, Dr. Sonia, be on stage.